Thank you so very much for joining us here today at Church on the Rock. We're so excited to have you, and we pray that God has a very specific word for you today. If you haven't checked out our website, let me urge you to go to jesusistherock.org. There you can find all of our latest news, blog posts, and messages. Also, while you're there, you can very easily give to our ministries financially by clicking on the giving button at the very top right-hand corner of the screen of any web page. Thank you again for joining us today, and let us prepare ourselves to hear from God.
In my opinion, Jonah is probably one of the most misunderstood people in all the Bible. If there was ever a Bible character who's taken a bad rap, I think it was Jonah. Was he perfect? No. But I haven't found but one in the whole Bible that was. The real problem with the book of Jonah is it's only four chapters long. And it only covers a very few days of this great prophet's life. Jonah is one other time. He's briefly mentioned in 2 Kings, and he's mentioned doing the work of the Lord. But I just believe it's unfair to take one unfortunate incident out of someone's life and form an opinion about them. See, no matter how good a person you might be and how much you love God and how wonderful you are and all this, how many have got some chapters in your life that would make for interesting reading too? Most of us do. See, nobody's ever written your whole life story, have they? How would you like for somebody to take out the worst chapter of your life and publish it and folks be reading it for the next 3,000 years? Jonah's been called prejudice. He's been called a coward, hard-headed, a bigot. All this for running away and not wanting to preach to the Ninevites. And so I guess I take this opportunity to sort of run to my brother Jonah's defense. Because I believe that even in this story, things are just not exactly as they appear. I started asking myself some time back, why didn't Jonah want to go to Nineveh? What's the problem? Why? What caused him to go book a ship and go in the opposite direction? I mean, I know the what, I just don't know the why. I know what he did, I just don't know why he did it. But there are some things that are not seen at first glance when you read this account of Jonah, and only after doing some study and quite a bit of Bible study and some history study can you begin to understand possibly not only what happened, but why it happened. Just for example, some of it is in simple translation. Verse number 3 says that Jonah rose up to flee from the presence of the Lord. Now, that's a little misleading. Have you stopped long enough to ask yourself why Jonah would flee from the presence of the Lord? First of all, that phrase, the way we understand it, is misleading. That's a Hebrew phrase, and it's actually a pretty common phrase. To operate in the office of the Lord, like a priest or a prophet, was called to be in the presence of the Lord. That's what it meant. If you were a priest or a prophet, you were in the presence of the Lord. What we understand to be the presence of the Lord, you can never flee from it any more than Jonah could. He knew that. I mean, he was a prophet of God, for Pete's sake. He's not so ignorant as to think he can hide from God. This is a man of God. This is a prophet of God. No, to flee from the presence of the Lord is simply to give up one's place of service to the Lord. Presence might be better translated work or call. He fled from the work of the Lord. He fled from the call of the Lord. Not the presence like we think of the presence of the Lord. He didn't think that he could go somewhere and God would not know where he was. Jonah was no ordinary run-of-the-mill man. He was a prophet sent from God, and there was placed on his life a tremendous anointing and tremendous blessing. And what's at stake here is his prophetic office. It's his ministry. That's what he's putting on the line. And for Jonah to flee from the presence of the Lord or flee from the work of the Lord is not to hide from God, but it's to willfully sacrifice his position, his call, his ministry. It's to put everything on the line. When he says, I'm fleeing from the presence of the Lord, I'm fleeing from my office, I'm fleeing from my call. And it was a great, great sacrifice for him to do this. But be much like today, if I were to forsake my calling, the calling that God's put on my life to preach the gospel, for whatever reason, I would, in their minds, I would flee from the presence of the Lord. Would I still be saved? Yes. Would God know where I was? Yeah, I think so. Would God still love me? Yeah. But what I would do is I would abandon that anointing and that blessing that God puts on my life to preach the gospel. If you're faithful to do what God calls you to do, you walk under God's anointing and God's blessing. It's the only way that I do what I do. But if not, you flee from the presence of the Lord. You flee from the anointing of the Lord, from the blessings of the Lord. See, God's not going to continue to anoint you to do something you're not doing. He's not going to continue to bless you to do something that you're not willing to do. It's like I've told you before, my youngest daughter, Brianna, when she was little, she wanted a lunchbox, she wanted a backpack, she wanted a school box, she wanted school clothes, she wanted all this stuff. Just one problem, she didn't want to go to school. She loved to go school shopping and get all the stuff and get dressed up like a schoolgirl. She just didn't want to go to school. She wanted the blessings without doing the work. Jonah, on the other hand, was not like that. Jonah knew what it would cost him. He knew the price. He knew he would be fleeing from the presence, from the work, from the call, fleeing from his ministry, and yet he was willing to make the sacrifice. But I still have to ask, why? Why? And that intrigues me. What was so bad about going to Nineveh and preaching there that would cause this great prophet of God to forsake everything that he's worked for, everything that he is, to throw it all away? What was Nineveh? Nineveh was what we would call the capital city of Syria. And Syria is on the rise at this time and quickly becoming a world power and a superpower. Her reputation for brutality was literally worldwide. Assyrians were to them what Nazis would be later to the Jews, only worse, if you can imagine that. Maybe what right now we see ISIS is to killing Christians. It was like that, only 1,000 times worse. Some of the things that history records the Syrians doing to the Jews are almost unspeakable. Things like when they would go in and take a city by force. Those that who survived the siege would be taken captive and taken back to Syria, and they would be staked out on the ground, and then sport would be made of them. They would be cut in very specific ways as to see who could get the skin off of them while they were still alive. And if they got the skin off of them, the skins would be hung on the side of their house as trophies. Pregnant mothers were all gathered up and they would cut them open to see who could get the most male babies out. They were a gory, gory group of people. Horrible group of people. Nobody liked Syrians, but everyone feared them. And God speaks to Jonah and tells him, go down and preach to Nineveh because their wickedness has come up before me. Now, Jonah tells the Lord later on in chapter 4, this is why I ran to Joppa. This is why I forsook my calling. This is why I gave up the blessings. He said, I knew you. I knew you. I knew how merciful you are. And if I went down there and preached, I knew they would repent. And you being merciful, you'd forgive them. And that's why I didn't go. And that's where we've gotten this idea that Jonah was a bigot and that he didn't want to go down and see these Assyrians saved and he was hard-hearted and all that. But we still have to answer the question, why? Why wouldn't Jonah want to go preach to these people? Why wouldn't he want to see them repent? Israel was, at this same time, turning their backs on God, as they often did. They were beginning to chase after other gods and walk away from Jehovah God, as they often did. And keep in mind, Jonah's no dummy. He's an anointed prophet of God. Jonah knows what's coming. God's fixing to bring Israel to her knees, like he always did when they would rebel against him. God would bring Israel to her knees, and they would repent, and God would bring them back. They were his chosen people. But Jonah knows, what better people to do that than Syria, the Ninevites? But God, he knew that God would not use Syria to chastise Israel if they were worse off than Israel. So God says, Jonah, go to Nineveh. Preach to the people. Jonah says, no way. Because if they repent, you'll forgive them. And then they'll come into Israel and destroy everything that walks. And Jonah loves these people. They're his people. But in Jonah's mind, he says, if I obey God and go to Nineveh and they repent, I'm signing a death warrant for my own people. Does that make sense? God's going to use them to go in and destroy my own people. So when I see Jonah fleeing to Joppa, I don't see some coward or some uncaring reprobate, but I see a prophet who loves his people so much that he's willing to give the ultimate sacrifice to him and give up his own ministry, his own life, his own office, everything that he is, give up his own ministry and flee from the call on, that God has on his life to save his own people. In fact, and don't read too much into this, but when I see Jonah, I see a type of Christ, a foreshadowing of Christ, one that's willing to lay down his own life for his people. Now that sort of puts a new perspective on this thing of Jonah. At least I understand why now. Sometimes we know if we know the why behind the what, it can shed a new light on things. Sometimes maybe I'll be a little less judgmental if I understand the why behind the what. I know he's a drunk. I just don't know why he's a drunk. I know they're a drug addict. I just don't know why they're a drug addict. I know she's done this. I just don't know why she did it. So that may be our lesson or our point. We'll call it that. Maybe tonight our point is to try and understand the why before we judge the what. It's easy for us to look at what somebody does and judge them based on their actions or what we perceive their actions to be. But sometimes there's a why behind the what that we don't know. And it can change things. Amen? Amen. I'm going to stop right there. I've got 4 more pages of notes, but I'm not going to do them tonight. It's some more things on Jonah that we may do later on, but tonight, for the purpose of this message, we're gonna stop right there. And just think on those things, and you may want to do some more reading and some research on your own. But Jonah was a fascinating character. I really wish we had more of Jonah's life to look at, and I think we would get a completely different picture of his life. Which one of us has not fled from doing what God's called us to do at some point in our life, doing the will of God? So, all right, we failed to receive offering earlier. It's been brought to my attention, and you're not getting out for free. So we're going to take the offering here at the end. So ushers, if you would go ahead and come tonight and come up, and then we're going to pray over you, and we're going to pray over the offerings. Tonight, if you've brought a gift or an offering or a tithe, whatever you may have brought with you, I just want you to get it out and hold it in your hand right now. And we just want to pray over it and bless it and pray that God will bless you back manyfold for your obedience, whatever you're bringing tonight. John says this over and over and over, but we are able to do what we do because you do what you do. all of us have a part in the body of Christ. So take it in your hand tonight and let's pray. Father, we just bless you and we praise you and we thank you, God, just for the opportunity to come together and to worship you in this place collectively, to put our hearts and our minds, Lord, together. And we just pray tonight that you bless the tithes or the gifts or the offerings or whatever is brought tonight. Lord, just bless everything that's given. And we ask it in your name.
Again, thank you so very much for joining us here today at Church on the Rock. I pray that our message has impacted you in a positive way. If you would like to share how our ministries are impacting you, you have a specific prayer request, or maybe you want more information about our church or how to get involved in our ministries, you can easily email us at pray@jesusistherock.org, or you can look us up on Facebook or Twitter at Church on the Rock, Pascagoula. Have a very blessed day. God raise up a generation.